That's who's there. Carried me back to old Virginia. There's where the cotton and the corn and taters.
But gentlemen, by the grace of God, we will not so tamely part with our king, and all these blessings we enjoy under him. And if they oppose us, do but follow me. I will either lead you to victory, or lose a life which I cannot more gloriously sacrifice than for my loyalty and your security. So said Governor Berkeley at the end of his speech delivered to the General Assembly in March 1651. Parliament sent a faction that removed Berkeley in April. The new governor's uncle was the Puritan Edward Bennett, founder of what became known as Bennett's Welcome. Because of this connection, Richard Bennett's elevation to the governor's office was a clear statement that the English Parliament now sought control of the colony. Thus, Virginia entered the Interregnum period. Berkeley's time was certainly numbered. As early as 1649, parliamentary influences, greatly influenced by leading Virginia merchants, sought to work around or remove the popular governor. Berkeley's influence in the assembly also couldn't be ignored. With leading Matthew's Claiborne faction members in England during the period, Berkeley had no trouble denouncing King Charles' beheading as traitorous, while also supporting the late king by calling him a saint. In addition, the assembly threw its support behind Charles II as the rightful English leader, and anyone claiming otherwise was guilty of high treason. Tensions between the Berkeley-led assembly and English Parliament continued to grow throughout 1650, especially as Parliament tried to monopolize Virginia trade. This is the situation in which Berkeley delivered his famous tirade. No one could doubt his position with words such as, "If the whole current of their reasoning were not as ridiculous as their actions have been tyrannical and bloody, we might wonder with what brows they could sustain such impertinent assertions. For if you look into it, the strength of their argument runs only thus. We have laid violent hands on your landlord, possessed his manor house where you used to pay your rents, therefore now tender your respects to the same house you once reverenced. They talk indeed of money laid out in this country in its infancy. I will not say how little, nor how centuply repaid, but will only ask, what is theirs? Surely, gentlemen, we are more slaves by nature than their power can make us if we suffer ourselves to be shaken with these paper bullets, and those on my life are the heaviest they either can or will send us." Stirring stuff. Dangerous, too, because it very much seemed as if the governor were looking for a fight. "What is it can be hoped for in a change, which we have not already? Is it liberty? The sun looks not on a people more free than we are from all oppression. Is it wealth? Hundreds of examples show us that industry and thrift in a short time may bring us to as high a degree of it as the country and our conditions are yet capable of. Is it securely to enjoy this wealth when gotten? Without blushing, I will speak it. I am confident there lives not that person can accuse me of attempting the least act against any man's property. Is it peace? The Indians, God be blessed round about us, are subdued. We can only fear the Londoners, who would fain bring us to the same poverty, wherein the Dutch found and relieved us, would take away the liberty of our consciences and tongues, and our right of giving and selling our goods to whom we please." One can almost anticipate the American War for Independence in Berkeley's words. If you didn't know that Berkeley spoke these words, you might guess that someone like Patrick Henry delivered them before the assembly. It was for words like these, very much so followed by actions, that Berkeley was so revered in the colony. Parliament understood that. They understood that with a man like Berkeley inciting such passion, a new fight could erupt across the Atlantic Ocean. Berkeley's words, therefore, forced Parliament to act. In the last episode, we had already seen that Parliament sent a fleet to subdue the colony, and that Berkeley submitted after a very tense standoff. Crisis was avoided after generous articles of submission were agreed upon. In those articles, things such as the immunity for words spoken against Parliament, the continuation of the General Assembly, land privileges, and free trade were secured. Berkeley then retired to his Greenspring plantation, and the General Assembly chose the well-connected Richard Bennett as the next governor to rule Virginia under Parliament's umbrella. What seemed like a serious crisis before 1652 realistically blew over with little effect. The effect was so minimal, in fact, that one can see an opening separation between England and Virginia. Virginians by the 1650s, though bound to England by cultural ties, simply had distinctly different concerns than their countrymen in the Isles. Historian Wilkham Washburn goes so far as to argue that local and self-interest begin to dominate Virginia's outlook as part of the resulting fallout from Charles' beheading. Supporting proof for Washburn's claim can be seen in the fact that the hated Navigation Acts were never realistically enforced after 1652. In fact, the leading Matthews-Claiborne faction attempted to have Parliament enforce the act, but Parliament never responded meaningfully. Instead, the colonists held to their claim that they were promised free trade with all nations by Parliament as stipulated in the Articles of Submission. In addition, Cromwell was expected to outline his plans for Virginia's government, but those plans never came either, thus allowing Virginia's colonial government to continue business much in the same way as it had before Berkeley's removal. Though government continued in mostly the same way as it had pre-1652, one noticeable change did occur. The governor's power was greatly undercut. As already mentioned, the General Assembly chose Richard Bennett as their next governor. Such an action put power in Virginians' hand at the expense of parliamentary involvement. The most obvious effect stemming from the manner in which Bennett was elected can be seen in land expansion. Virginia had been growing quite modestly during the 1620s to the 1640s, but that expansion ran through the governor's office, who granted land in the name of the king. Now there wasn't a king, and the governor answered to the people who had elected him into office. Bennett, therefore, sought in his best interest to liberally grant land. A little more context should be added here, while also showing how closely tied together Virginians of this period and later generations actually were. Bennett certainly wasn't a dithering figurehead. He was extremely well-connected and can be seen as a progenitor of many first family of Virginia genealogies. Richard's wife was the former Mary Ann Ute, widow of the once prominent councilmember John Ute, the same John Ute who, along with John West, was also instrumental in settling lands near modern Yorktown. Richard and Mary Ann gave birth to three children. Their son Richard Jr. married the prominent Maryland planter James Neal's daughter, Henrietta Maria. Their daughters, Anna and Elizabeth, both married into powerful families that figured prominently in Virginia's history. Anna, for her part, married her first husband, Theodoric Bland of Westover. They had three sons together, Theodoric, the inheritor of Westover Plantation, and who also surveyed Howson's Patent, which became today's Alexandria, as well as Williamsburg in the year that it became Virginia's new capital. Middle son Richard Bland I of Jordan's Point fathered five children, Mary, Elizabeth, Anna, Theodoric, and Richard II, with his wife Elizabeth Randolph, daughter of major colonial merchant and politician William Randolph of Turkey Island. Richard and Elizabeth's five children also feature very prominently in Virginia's history, including oldest daughter Mary, who married Henry Lee I and became Light Horse Harry Lee's grandparents, as well as Robert E. Lee's great-grandparents. Another of Richard and Elizabeth Bland's daughters, also named Elizabeth, married William Beverly, son of the prominent 17th-century historian Robert Beverly. Their son Theodoric Bland married Frances Bowling, from the powerful Bowling family. Together they had five children, perhaps none more prominent than Theodoric, who was extremely influential during the American War for Independence and subsequent founding of the new nation. Richard and Mary's last son, Richard II of Jordan Point, married Anne Poitras, had three children, all of whom by this point in Virginia's interwoven genealogies were cousins to the Randolphs and Jeffersons, to name a few. Going back to Richard and Mary Ann Bennett for a second, their youngest daughter Elizabeth married prominent Eastern Shore planter and merchant Edmund Scarborough's son Charles. Important information to remember when considering events unfolding on the Eastern Shore during the Interregnum period. Charles and Elizabeth had a daughter that later married Major George Parker of Accomack County. With increasingly dense familial connections like Richard Bennett's in mind, colonial Virginia grew very much like a large family. A large family that Bennett had to keep in order. Oftentimes, unruly family members simply left to blaze their own trail. In addition to ever-widening expansion came new challenges to the colonial government. Bennett and his assembly meeting in Jamestown simply couldn't spread their influence meaningfully enough throughout the colony. Thus, such far-flung places as the Eastern Shore or the Northern Neck believed that they could best govern themselves independently. Up until this point in Virginia's history, land expansion had been a key issue separating colonists and Indians. Berkeley's actions demarcated who owned what lands. But Bennett's election changed the governmental structure in that former lines were removed. No longer would a somewhat distant official dictate what lands could be owned by whomever wanted those lands. Bennett's, and subsequent governors', position was far more conciliatory. The Eastern Shore felt the most notable immediate impact. Before Berkeley's removal, the Eastern Shore's most prominent settlers, such as leading merchant Edmund Scarborough, who wrote a paper that the Assembly deemed scandalous and seditious, quickly fell afoul of the Assembly. Berkeley had done much to protect the Laughing King's people on the Eastern Shore. But all of that work was undone after 1652. Scarborough and a new colonial influx brought fresh attacks against the once friendly Eastern Shore tribes. And with each newly arriving colonist, more land was taken without support of the Jamestown government. Berkeley, later Bennett, and then Edward Diggs sought to curtail expansion through various means. But they simply couldn't do anything meaningful to stop the Indian land from being taken. Men like Scarborough just didn't care what Jamestown had to say. They had means and connections outside of the colony which together influenced men like Scarborough to act more independently. Because of actions like Scarborough's and other men, Northampton County did indeed receive a form of semi-autonomy. The county's leaders had petitioned the General Assembly asking to be allowed to separate themselves from the mainland since the 1640s. Each petition was rejected until the Assembly finally allowed the distant renegade settlers to establish their own laws and customs. This action put the final nails, so to speak, in the native Eastern Shore tribes' coffin. Their lands were completely taken, and many of those subjugated tribes were sold into the growing slave network that men like William Claiborne and indeed Edmund Scarborough sponsored. In fact, it was Scarborough who worked with the Dutch in New Amsterdam to bring slaves to the Eastern Shore during the 1640s. As T.H. Breen and Stephen Innes wrote, blacks living on the Eastern Shore until the 1640s were largely free, and many, such as Anthony Johnson, owned considerable acreage. That situation began to change slowly but surely during this time, and can be illustrated by men like Anthony Johnson's leaving his land for Maryland pastures not soon thereafter. Land expansion also continued along Virginia's extensive river network. Key lands being claimed during the 1650s came along the Potomac River's banks. Much of these claims stemmed from the deposed King Charles II's bestowing a massive 1649 grant to seven of his closest supporters. But more on that in future episodes. Established merchants and settlers who had access to Virginia's waterways benefited most during this period. They easily sailed up the Potomac and claimed land, usually by spotting landmarks and claiming territory between those landmarks, regardless of who might already inhabit the land. As such, tensions continued to increase along the frontier regions during what became known as the Beaver Wars. Traditionally out-of-state tribes started coming into contact with tradesmen. Some of those tribes filled power vacuums created after the English smashed Powhatan dominance in the 1640s. As a result, the English had to navigate new Indian concerns in the 1650s. But this time, more congenial leaders like Berkeley weren't on the scene. Instead, Many of the previously hostile merchanting network were called into action by the assembly, who gave directives not to use force unless necessary. But many of those leaders already had it in mind that force was necessary. The Richehekrians, as the colonials called them, moved from the northwestern mountainous regions into lands near Richmond in 1654. Their new settlements spooked nearby English colonists, prompting the assembly to send Colonel Edward Hill with 100 men to meet the strangers, as they were also called. Supposedly, the meeting was to head off any trouble before it started, but the inclusion of 100 Pamunkey warriors led by Totopotamoy signaled Hill's intent. He wanted to fight. The ensuing skirmish, known as the Battle of Bloody Run, went poorly, and wasn't to have taken place at all. Hill nefariously reached out to the Richehekrian leaders, five of whom came to parley. All five were put to death. Outraged, the Richehekrians understandably attacked Hill's army. During the course of events that followed, the English ally and Pamunkey chief Totopotamoy was killed, which became an unforgettable wound for the chieftain's wife, Kukukweski, who brought the incident up more than 20 years later. Upon receiving word of the battle, the assembly denounced Hill in no uncertain terms. His action was rightly called perfidious, barbarous, hellish, treacherous, anti-Christian, inhumane, abominable, stinking, and aberrant, to name a few words that bled from one Gatford's pen. Gatford also realized that Hill's action would create further distance between the Indians and the English, distance that might not be healed until a new, better generation takes the current generation's place. The assembly concurred with Gatford's assessment of Hill, and unanimously found the colonel guilty of crimes and weaknesses. The governing body then removed Hill from all of his colonial offices and made him liable for the charge of not procuring a peace with the Indians with whom he had so treacherously dealt, as Washburn puts it. Abraham Wood took over Hill's former position on the frontier. He, along with the assembly's backing, now felt it necessary to create some form of Indian protection along the frontier reaches. That protection allowed frontier outposts like Wood's at Fort Henry to expand. Within a generation, Wood's expeditions from Fort Henry created a thriving network that his son-in-law Peter Jones took over by the 1670s. Wood and Jones' trade network attracted leading families such as the Bollings and the Byrds into the region. In fact, it was William Byrd II who honored Peter Jones' diligence by naming the formerly designated Peter's Point as Petersburg, which it is still known as today. Though the assembly said they wanted peace with the Indians, in another breath, they passed legislation forming new counties northwest of Lancaster County along the Rappahannock River. Still, over the next couple of years, the assembly passed new bills attempting to guarantee Indian lands and freedoms. The Strongest Act tried to stop new English land grants from occurring by offering 50 acres of land for each bowman that a tribe might have. But as new colonists continued arriving, and old colonists continued moving around the region, the assembly found it increasingly difficult to enforce their proposed laws, many of which would have been passed against their own family members. The bottom line was that the incoming colonists had the wherewithal to withstand often toothless assembly legislation. They also had the firepower to take matters into their own hands when they deemed it necessary. The volatile mixture ensured frontier violence would continue for the foreseeable future. Another reason why the assembly couldn't seem to quell frontier violence had to do with the religious differences between the interregnum leaders, who were largely Puritan, and the newly arriving interregnum settlers, who were largely Anglican or otherwise not Puritan. The governor was to act in Parliament's interest, but his limited tenure, which was only supposed to be for 1 year, accompanied with the fact that the governing council and general assembly usually didn't care what the Parliament had to say, meant that the governor, starting with Richard Bennett, would largely be ineffectual. Added to the mix was the fact that Parliament's correspondence, when it came, was increasingly sparse at best. They also didn't seem to care about Virginia, and soon, the General Assembly assumed more power as a response. One of those powers involved electing governors, like they did at first with Richard Bennett, instead of being told who the governor would be. That being so, governors during the interregnum were almost placeholders more than effectual colonial leaders. Bennett finished his term, and then the assembly elected Edward Diggs of Belfield Plantation on the York River. Diggs left little impact on the government. He was much more interested in cultivating silk at Belfield before he decided to sail back to England in 1656. The assembly then elected Samuel Matthews, Jr. into the governorship. His accession to the office came at an important time in that there was an assembly-sponsored expedition into what is today North Carolinian waterways, such as Cape Fear, down to Cape Hatteras. This expedition, along with former Governor Bennett's interest in Maryland lands, created new contention between the Chesapeake Bay neighbors that also highlighted older settlement issues, especially along religious lines. Bennett moved to Anne Arundel, Maryland, in 1648, and settled Greenberry Point, with other Puritans escaping Governor Berkeley's increasingly anti-Puritan actions. Bennett didn't live in Maryland long, however, before Parliament called him back to England as a sort of colonial diplomat. It was from this work that Bennett became Parliament's choice, along with William Claiborne, to reduce Virginia and Maryland to their due obedience to the Commonwealth of England in 1652. Bennett's gubernatorial election answered the Virginia portion of Parliament's commission, but he was still tasked to bring Maryland in line. Former original Berkeley Hundred settler and Puritan William Stone had moved to the eastern shore by the 1630s and patented 1,800 acres in Accomack County. He quickly rose through Virginia's trade ranks, married Captain Thomas Graves' daughter, Verlinda, and became a sheriff as well as a vestryman in the 1640s. When trouble arose between Virginia's Puritans and Governor Berkeley, Stone was one of those who asked Cecilius Calvert, Lord Baltimore, if he could find refuge in Maryland. Even though Baltimore was Catholic, he consented, and Stone moved. With that move came Stone's being elevated into Maryland's governorship at Baltimore's request. This signaled Maryland's move toward religious toleration that ultimately ended with Stone's signing the famous 1649 Religious Toleration Act. Virginia's Puritans, which, as already mentioned, included Richard Bennett, flooded into Maryland and created the town of Providence, today's Annapolis, on the Severn River. Stone continued to rule the colony with little trouble until the mid-1650s. In 1654, parliamentary forces took over Maryland after they had won the third portion of the English Civil War. Though Stone was a Puritan, he was a friend of the Calverts, who were royalists. Being a friend of the Calverts also meant that Stone was, by association, William Claiborne's enemy. That being said, pressure from Bennett and Claiborne forced Stone into a brief exile before Stone returned with an army in 1655. But the ensuing Battle of Severn in March 1655 was a failure. Stone lost, was taken prisoner, and replaced by Josias Fendall. With Stone's loss, both of Bennett's commissions were completed. Yet trouble between Maryland and Virginia remained beyond Bennett's tenure. Conflict with Lord Baltimore in Maryland arose when Baltimore wrote to Cromwell claiming that he and his colony had secured rights to search the very same North Carolinian waterways that the Virginia Assembly sponsored. Cromwell, in a rare correspondence with the colonies, first sided with Baltimore. Sort of. He requested the Virginians to go back to former status before the acts were passed. In addition, strident Virginians applied considerable pressure against Baltimore's colony in an attempt to take lands from Maryland. Cromwell ordered such intrusion to cease. In time, emissaries from both colonies hashed out agreements that ensured religious toleration remained in Maryland, thus allowing former Virginians to keep their lands. But those lands would remain part of Maryland and not become part of Virginia, as many had tried to make happen. The North Carolinian waterways were not awarded to either colony. Also during the boundary dispute between Virginia and Maryland, a noticeable settler influx brought well-to-do families along the Potomac's southern bank. Some of these early settlers headed what are today almost mythical families. They were such men as Richard Lee, Henry Corbin, Isaac Allerton, William Ball, as well as the Washington brothers John and Lawrence. These men were industrious, diligent, and became very well connected. Their children married one another, and bonds between the families only increased over both the short and long term. They also connected with nearby colonists such as Lewis Burwell, the well-established middle plantation planter, and others along the Rappahannock River, just south of the Northern Neck. With the arrival of these families, one can certainly see a noticeable shift in the power centers of Virginia. Northern communities eventually began heavily swaying political events that happened throughout the colony. The last interregnum governor, Samuel Matthews Jr., came into power during March 1658. It seemed that most issues were, for the time being, satisfactorily answered, and that the colony could move forward under the parliamentary banner. But Matthews decided to steer the colony's government into a different direction. The 1658 assembly began with discussion of republican governmental principles. Such discussion affirmed the assembly's authority to elect the governor and his council, because the assembly had the people's authority behind their individual elections. Matthews disagreed. Within a few days of the assembly's initial meeting, he dissolved the body. The House of Burgesses immediately rebuked Matthews' improper decision and told him to retract his command to dissolve. Matthews responded that he would, if the Burgesses would send their petition to the Lord Protector. The assembly then formed a committee to discuss their rights. They reaffirmed their constitutional rights as representatives of the people and could not be dissolved by the governor's command. Matthews, therefore, was forced to relent. He still wanted to submit the assembly's petition to the Lord Protector, but they resolutely refused. The assembly further commanded William Claiborne to hand over colonial records to John Smith, Speaker of the Assembly, which now held supreme power in Virginia, much to Matthews' chagrin. Eventually, Matthews gave in and submitted to the assembly's demand that he appear in person and agree with them that supreme power lay with them, not the governor. His action ameliorated all parties, which paved the way for the assembly's re-electing Matthews for another 2 years. Virginia had entered a very brief period in which local government reigned supreme. Granted, much of that government was often nepotistic, but those outside of the largest planters benefited from such decentralized actions. The Matthews-Claiborne faction, still powerful, mind you, was put in its proper place, especially as the wealthy, more northerly settlers began flexing their muscles. London was also told how the colony would be governed, not the other way around. Oddly enough, by the end of the interregnum period, tensions with most Indians were decreasing. A lot of this came about because the assembly removed trade restrictions on all goods, including guns and ammunition, for instance. Land concerns were certainly still top of the list between the English and the Indians. English encroachment upon Indian land, as well as disease and warfare, certainly didn't help matters. But the willingness to freely trade between both groups lessened tensions dramatically. Then, it all changed once again. Richard Cromwell, son of Oliver, Lord Protector of the English Commonwealth, decided to resign. England would once again become a monarchy. And at about the same time, Samuel Matthews Jr. suddenly passed away in 1660. Virginia would need a new governor, and they turned to a familiar face. Berkeley, the crown's loyal supporter, who was still living in Virginia during the time, would once again be called into action. Thank you again for supporting the podcast. It's greatly appreciated. Please continue to spread the word and help this colony to keep growing. Start by following us on your favorite podcast provider, like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, and visit the website. Sharing episodes and other work is the best way to expand the community. Another way to greatly aid the podcast is by providing feedback on iTunes. If you have yet to do so, please take a few minutes and leave us a comment. Doing so helps bring exposure in the iTunes network. It also helps me to know what I need to improve on in future episodes. If you would like to support the work financially, please consider supporting the podcast on Patreon. Links can be found on the website, or one can visit the campaign at patreon.com/VAHISPOD to see the choices and rewards being offered for your generosity. And please, join me next time as we continue walking through Virginia's history. Oh, my brother.
Bad do bad, do 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 do